You know, sometimes they refer to this lunar roving vehicle as a moon buggy. Now, we didn't like that name because it's a spacecraft on wheels. Our ship carried 4,000 Hungarian refugees from Europe to New York City harbor, and many of the refugees were seasick. They were awakened when they see the Statue of Liberty and the New York skyline, and we all got very excited waiting what is going to happen. There was a delegation waiting for us, and they announced that buses will be carrying us to a refugee camp, which was in Camp Kilmer, New Jersey. We, at the time, were very appreciated by the West because we were freedom fighters against the communist Soviet regime. We had a fabulous standard Navy meal at the camp, which after the refugee camps in Europe were heavenly for all of us. 5 days after arriving to the refugee camp in New Jersey, a gentleman came by from General Motors, Detroit, and he was looking for scientists and engineers to set up a new laboratory which had the purpose of investigating mobility over off-the-road conditions. Now, I did not speak English at the time. Fortunately, this gentleman spoke German, and he actually interviewed me in German and hired me on that basis. So they told me, now you have a job offer, we're going to give you a train ticket to Detroit, here is $5, now you are on your own. We all five of us enrolled at the local university on evening English for foreign students classes. And it's amazing, when you must, you can learn so fast. So in 3 months, we were able to communicate and get along with other people in the laboratory. The first years of my working with GM in this research laboratory was not related at all to what NASA was doing. As a matter of fact, I didn't even hear about NASA in the first couple of years of my working here. We were evaluating the mobility of different types of vehicles, mostly for army and agricultural purposes. And during that time, I finally mastered the English language and started my real engineering career. But in 1961, General Motors decided to transfer that part of the GM research organization to Santa Barbara from Detroit. It was called the GM Defense Research Laboratory, and our objective was to work for the U.S. Army, Navy, Air Force, and aerospace projects. So this is how I got to Santa Barbara, and we set up our laboratory here. At the peak, we had as many as 1,200 people working in the lab. In 61, when President Kennedy announced the Apollo lunar program, that we are going to send people to the moon and bring them back safely, that's where I started to get aware of what NASA is doing in this area. And we were thinking that, well, if they get there, it would be nice for them to have a vehicle to drive away from the landing site and explore areas farther away, which is more interesting for scientists. So we started thinking about what kind of vehicles would be good for the moon surface. At that time, there was not much known about the moon. And some scientists speculated that the lunar surface is covered with a deep layer of very loose, fluffy material, and everything you put on is going to sink down. So we came up with vehicle concepts, including big wheels, track-laying vehicles like tanks, and we even came up with an Archimedean screw-type vehicle, which could burrow through loose soil material, even if it's submerged. Now, in the mid-60s, they landed two surveyor spacecrafts on the moon, which were robotic unmanned spacecrafts, and they didn't sink into the surface. As a matter of fact, they found that the lunar surface has a fairly good capacity to support weight. It is covered with a thin layer of dusty material, but below that, it's very firm, like beach sand. So we gave up all the exotic vehicle concepts and concentrated on wheels. And that's how our effort in getting involved with moon mobility started. Now, the first effort under contract with NASA was a remote-controlled, six-wheeled, about 5-foot-long vehicle, fairly small vehicle, which was going to go on the Surveyor spacecraft. Now, we built a test model, an engineering model for NASA, which we delivered for their testing. But this program never got to the moon because of time restraints, and also they were running short of money. When NASA started working on the Apollo program, they have very ambitious plans. One was to send up to the moon a mobile lunar laboratory, which they called MOLAB, which was a pressurized cabin type of vehicle capable of carrying two astronauts in a short sleeve environment for 14 days exploration of the lunar surface. Now, we get a contract from NASA to work on that MOLAB project. We designed a vehicle for that purpose, actually built an engineering model and tested it over the Yuma sand dune proving grounds. And we're ready to proceed, you know, as soon as NASA orders the real thing. Unfortunately, it turned out that this vehicle weighed 8,000 pounds and was large, and it would have required a separate Saturn V big rocket. Okay, that rocket was specifically developed for the Apollo program. It was 300 foot long and had a thrust capability of 1 million pounds and was very expensive. So it became apparent to NASA they cannot afford to send up two of these expensive rockets, one carrying the astronauts, the other carrying the MOLAB vehicle. So NASA essentially given up on putting vehicles on the moon within the Apollo project. They were concentrating on their major objective is to send people to the moon and bring them back. Now, we at General Motors Research didn't give up, however. We thought that a vehicle could be incorporated into the existing Apollo lunar landing module. And if that's possible, then the astronauts still can have mobility rather than just walking around the landing site. So we, on our own funding, because NASA was not interested anymore, came up with a concept and were trying to sell the idea to NASA that, hey, this is possible to put a rover on the existingly designed lunar module. So then to help our presentations to the various NASA centers, and we went to Washington, to the headquarters, Houston, where they were responsible for the manned lunar program. And we also went to Huntsville, Alabama, where the NASA Center was responsible for the mobility out of this world. So to aid our presentations, we built a little scale model. First, we went to NASA to ask them what space is available on the already designed lunar landing module to put a rover in. And they identified a little corner between two legs of the landing device, which was available and empty. And it was 60 inch high, 60 inch wide, and 36 inch deep in a triangular shape envelope. So our question was, how do you put a Jeep-sized vehicle into a space which is not bigger than the back of a station wagon? So we came up with a concept which we demonstrated with this little 1/6 scale model. And we actually took that along to aid our presentations to the various NASA centers. So we, once in Huntsville, where Dr. von Braun, who was the inventor, designer of the Saturn V rocket, he was the director of the NASA Center. And we gave a presentation to the engineering group, showed them the model, and they were so excited, say, hey, why don't we show it to Dr. von Braun? So they led us to his office, opened his office door. I guided the little model with radio control into his room, right to his desk, and he was on the telephone looking at what's coming into his office. I put down the telephone, and then we walked in and then showed him the model and explained the whole story. We had to fold up the vehicle. First, the seat had to be folded down. Then the front chassis, which was hinged, folded over 180 degrees. Then the rear part of the chassis folded over. Then the wheels and suspension, which was canted, pulled over, so they formed a 90 degree angle. So this package now could fit right into that corner of the lunar module, which, as I said, was not bigger than the back of a station wagon. Doing the deployment, okay, you had to do the reverse. You unfolded the front chassis, and this was all spring-loaded hinges. You just released the latch and it opened up automatically. The same way the wheels swung out to their proper position. They repeated this on the rear part of the vehicle. Out with the wheels, then they separated from the lunar lander and the vehicle was underground. The chairs would have to be open up and the astronaut can be seated and ready to go. Now, it was a family project to make this model. I made it myself. with the help of my wife, sowing the seeds together. And I stole the G.I. Joe from my son, who was 7 years old at the time. And they just came out with an astronaut suit for G.I. Joe. So this little model really served its purpose. And it was really helpful in convincing NASA that it is possible to put a jeep-sized vehicle carrying two astronauts on the moon within the designed Apollo system. It was very exciting for me to work on this project, especially because there was a kind of a competition between America and the Soviet Union, who gets to space in first, who gets to the moon first. So it was in the middle of the Cold War period. For me, as a Hungarian who escaped from the communist regime, it was especially important to win the competition against the Soviets. So shortly after our visit to von Braun's office, NASA came out with a request for proposal for a rover for the Apollo program. So they were convinced that it can be done. So they issued a request because they cannot award a contract without competition. So that we did have competition, the Grumman Corporation, Boeing, Bendix Corporation, they all bid on the program, but we won the competition, and specifically because our concept of being able to fold the vehicle together and put it into that corner. The other offers were all wheel hanging all over outside the envelope of the lunar landing module. So we got the contract finally. And at that time, we had 18 months left to design, develop, test, and build the first space-qualified lunar rover. At the beginning, we were a small group of maybe 5-6 people who were working on our own, pretty much, when we were trying to convince NASA about the program. But once we got the contract, we had to build up to a full-board team. And at the peak, we had as many as 400 people working on the project. I was the chief engineer, and I organized my engineering team such a way that each major subsystem, like the wheel, the electric drive for the wheels, the steering system, the controls, they were each headed by one engineer who had his own team of designers, technicians, and he was responsible for the whole thing from the beginning of the design throughout the testing and the successful delivery. Everybody was extremely enthusiastic about the project. I never needed to urge somebody that, hey, work a little faster, could you come in Saturday or something? It was just a very enthusiastic team because the project was very interesting. It was also my most, let's say, not just difficult, but the most satisfying project in my engineering career. Because the time constraint of the 18 months, we were not sure what approach will be successful. So in a critical areas like wheel and the electric drive system, we started up with parallel efforts with separate design engineers in charge, so that whichever approach came to fruition in time then was selected. And this way we have to discard several wheel design approaches as well as electric drive approaches before the successful one was selected, which was not necessarily technically the best approach, but it had to do because the time was running out. It's a spacecraft on wheels, because it had to confine to the strict NASA requirements for manned spaceflight, which was extremely strict. The reliability factor was requested at 99.9%. So every aspect of the operation had to be very reliable. They required redundancy. That's why we had electric drive for each wheel separately. So if one breaks down, the others are still working. We had steering on both front and rear. So with one steering, it can work, as it proved on the Apollo 15. And everything else, like the batteries, we have two separate battery packages, which each could drive the vehicle separately. So we had redundancy throughout the design, as well as the high reliability, which had to be proven by testing. So we had very strict NASA requirements to design to, including the performance parameters to reach 10 miles per hour top speed, being able to climb slopes of up to 25 degrees across craters, and have energy requirements low enough so that the two battery packs could cover up to 75 miles of range. Now, as far as testing for all these requirements, okay, it was very tricky in some areas. We did have huge vacuum chambers where the complete rover, what we call is a qualification test vehicle, which was identical to the ones sent to the moon, they could be put inside the chamber with the temperature changing from the minus to the plus range, and the vehicle driven over a simulated mission, and the vacuum could also be simulated. Now, there was a big question, how do you simulate the reduced gravity? Well, what we finally ended up with is that we put the vehicle on a treadmill, and the treadmill was rotating under the wheels, and we tilted the treadmill surface to 82 degrees so that the normal force to the surface of the treadmill was exactly 1/6 of the weight of the vehicle. So this was the trick we simulated the low gravity with, and then together with the temperature ranges and the vacuum, we could actually test the vehicle under simulated lunar conditions. So it was an excitingly tight schedule. I was working practically day and night. Family hardly seen me. Apollo 15 was the fourth Apollo flight, okay? We had information back from the Apollo 11, 12, and 14. And after every flight, there was a debriefing. We could ask astronauts questions. So we learned quite a lot from Armstrong and company when they came back and described what the surface is like, you know, how it behaves. And so we used that information in designing the wheel, for instance, the chevron cover of the wheel, how much supporting surface we need so the wheel doesn't sink down too much. So we learned quite a bit from the previous Apollo flights and adjusted our design. One of the major challenges in design was the wheel itself. Since we could not use rubber tires or plastic materials because of the high and low temperatures, at the low temperature, the rubber would become like glass and would shatter. So we had to come up with an all-metal wheel design. And we tested different types, at least a half a dozen wheel designs we came through, and finally ended up with this wire mesh type of a design, which resembles a tire, but it's made out of metal. The hub is made out of aluminum and the rim. And you see an inside tire, which is made out of titanium spring. And the purpose of that secondary tire is to take the shock impact forces. Since the wheel had to be flexible enough to deform under the lunar weight, which was only about 60 pounds, but it had to take a shock load, an impact force of up to 600 pounds in case it runs into a big rock or an obstacle at the top speed. So we had to design for both possibilities. Now, the surface of the wheel is covered with titanium strips, which had the purpose of providing flotation over the soft surface and also develop traction to grab into the surface to climb hills and overcome obstacles. Now, we also consider the possibility that a wheel drive mechanism fails and freezes. In that case, instead of dragging the wheel, we provided a disconnection capability, and the wheel would free run on this titanium bearing surface. So the three wheels would continue to drive, and the failed wheel would just roll with the rest of them. Now, this was very important, and JPL just found out with their Mars rover design, where they had a failed wheel drive, which blocked and immobilized the little rover. So one of their rovers failed on Mars. Because of this problem, they did not provide a freewheeling capability. This particular wheel was a test wheel for durability testing. We tested for 120 miles over rugged surface with sandy material over which some rocks were superimposed. So it survived 120 miles of testing. So when the first one arrived to the moon, and I was sitting at the Houston Control Center to be available if there is any problem. They landed successfully. They deployed the vehicle successfully, and we were all watching that on television as the wheels comes out, you know, we elated. Great, you know, it's down on the surface. And then they started checking out the systems, all the electrical systems, drive, steering, everything. And Dave Scott, the commander, reported back that the front steering is not working because we had four-wheel steering. The rear steering was functioning, but the front was not. So they rushed out to my office there at the control center. Okay, what to do? So I wrote down on a piece of paper that exercise the control stick left and right many times to have it warmed up. By the time my note got to the captain of communication, NASA has made the decision to go ahead with the mission with only one steering. So they did. They went ahead, completed the first excursion, which they had a map for exactly where to go, where to stop, where to collect samples, and how to come back. So they completed the first of the 3-day mission, came back, went to sleep, Next morning they come out and checked out the system again. And then Dave Scott says, hey, everything is working. Front steering, rear steering, everything. So he jokingly said that, well, you guys must have come up here at night and fixed it. So what happened was that the system warmed up and made proper electrical contact, and therefore from then on everything was working. So they completed the second excursion and the third day, the third excursion, and collected hundreds of pounds of samples and rocks which they brought back with them. And on Apollo 16, we were successful in persuading NASA to have a little test drive, documented test drive, prior to going out on a mission. So the commander, Jim Young, was going to drive the rover in a figure eight to show all the features of acceleration, top speed, braking, tight turns and everything. And Charlie Duke, the other astronaut, was taking video of this action. It shows very well how the vehicle functions in a low gravity environment. As the wheels are bouncing, sometimes the whole vehicle off the ground. And as it stops, you know, and skids, digs into the soil. It was exciting for us to see actually how it performs under that lunar environment. And on Apollo 17, the last one, after deployment of the vehicle, one of the astronauts accidentally ripped off the fender extension. It needed a fender to prevent the dust to fly all over in the low gravity. So that about a foot long section of the fender was ripped off, and they said, well, no problem, we just go without it. But as soon as they started, they noticed that the dust was thrown up and settled all over their spacesuit, which was unacceptable because the thermal control of the spacesuit. So they stopped and they came up with a quick fix. They had plastic maps for their excursion, which was made of fairly stiff plastic. And they improvised it with clips and duct tape. They attached that plastic piece to the fender to replace the broken off part. And then they completed all 3 days' mission with this quick fix. So altogether, all three lunar rover programs were successful. The astronauts were very complimentary of the performance, and they were able to travel about 60 miles altogether, get away as far as 10 miles away from the lunar lander. So they were able to visit the geologically interesting points, like a big crater or a foot of a mountain or a canyon or whatever the geologists were interested in. So altogether it was a very successful program, and it was a great satisfaction for us who worked on the program. I am frequently asked what was the major challenge in designing or coming up with this program. And our major challenge was first convincing NASA that this program is possible. Second, that we have left 18 months, which was a very short time for a space program, to complete the program. Then there were the environmental factors, the low gravity on the moon, the extreme temperatures, which range from minus 250 degrees Fahrenheit at night to plus 250 Fahrenheit during the day. And then the very difficult terrain, There are craters superimposed on craters, so there's a very rough surface covered with a very soft layer of material. So we have overcome all those technical problems. The design process is going on during work as well as after work. Okay? Sometimes your best ideas come to you sitting in a bathtub and comes to you, oh yeah, that's how we would do it. So you get out and make some sketches the next day to work on the problem, and it turns out to be a successful solution. When the first rover astronauts came back from the moon and we had a debriefing with them, we asked them, is there anything which we could change or we should change, any complaints or anything? And their comment was that everything worked perfectly, and we have not made any changes from the first rover on 15 to the last rover to the 17. So it was right away a successful design, and we were very pleased and satisfied with that. And even if today I would have to design one, there wouldn't be too many changes. We would probably pick a different battery, because the battery technology has developed now, and there are much better, higher energy density batteries available today. We would probably pick a different electric motor, because AC motors control has developed in the meantime, so it would be more efficient and lighter weight. I don't think how we would make the wheel better, so we probably use the same design. But we did proceed and succeeded in delivering the vehicle on time, ready for the Apollo 15 flight. So the last three flights of the six Apollo landers used the lunar rover, 15, 16, and 17. And they were all successful.